My name is Harendra Sirisena. Everybody calls me Harold, so feel free to do so. It's certainly not a problem. And I was born in Sri Lanka, came to America 25 years ago. A little bit of my education. I have a degree in mathematics and economics from the City University system. And then I have an MPhil from Columbia University in economics and an MPhil from the New School for Social Research. Now it's New School University in economic development. In both cases, I was too lazy to finish up my PhD. My background in employment is very much related to socio-economic development. I worked for British American Tobacco as an agricultural instructor for 14 years, and there I came across the government's poverty alleviation programs. I was appointed to the board and worked with, I mentioned a little bit in my speech, so I can talk about that later. Right now I work for the City University in the business office in student finance, and I've been here for 10 and a half years at the City University. So let me, as a person who is very much affected by the tsunami from Sri Lanka, I'm seated here today in front of you to talk about it. Let me start this thanking Dr. Tam for giving me this opportunity to sit with you, and also to have a lively discussion after I finish up my essay. And right through, I will of course need a lot of help from Dr. Tam about Buddhism and other things, and Dr. Chirkapalli about the technicalities of all these things. So let me start. As my presentation is concerned, as far as that is concerned, it is about issues one must be familiar with to effectively advance the relief effort in Sri Lanka, my native land. And my talk is briefly divided into two parts, two little chapters. They are, number one, psychosocial counseling, and socioeconomic development. I made that a very broad topic instead of saying infrastructure development. I brought the socioeconomic part into it, mainly because of the number of professionals we have lost, school teachers. So there is a lot of human resources training necessary. So I made it a very broad topic. The issues one must be conversant with when working in Sri Lanka are not much different from the issues which influence disaster situations and development projects in the rest of the world. However, I will try to wrap those issues pertaining to Sri Lanka around the subject matter in this essay as embedded in Sri Lanka's historical, religious, societal, ethnic, and economic beliefs and practices. It was 2 months ago that the tsunami struck in our world, already punctured by heart-wrenching humanitarian crises in Darfur, Rwanda, the Congo, Uganda, HIV/AIDS, and a war in Iraq. In our hearts and minds, and in the global consciousness, tsunami must not eclipse those crises. The tsunami was just a fleeting repetition in our expanding evolving universe. But it was a cruel moment of a brutal assault. The March issue of the Scientific American, which is out now, under the heading The Scarred Earth, Madhusri Mukherjee from Calcutta, writes, I quote, "The magnitude 9.0 earthquake was the largest ever recorded in the region, and the world's biggest since the 1964 Alaskan quake. The tsunami traveled at 700 kilometers per hour, sweeping away some 225,000 lives and millions of livelihoods across 12 nations, end quote. However, the death toll is, I think, a little over 300,000. In Sri Lanka, it killed more than 35,000 people, one-third of them children, displaced over 1 million people, and orphaned 4,300 children. The economic damage is currently estimated at $3.5 billion. Currently, in refugee camps, there are over 40,000 survivors, their social structures broken down, and livelihoods lost. Others who survived are living with their extended families, a very common phenomenon in our part of the world, Sri Lanka, India, Thailand, Indonesia, China. Among the survivors are the maimed, some physically, and a very large number mentally. A UNICEF psychologist, whose name does not appear in the Time magazine article I'm quoting from, said, after visiting a makeshift refugee camp, that he saw homelessness, desolation, estrangement, and destitution. The world is confronted with a different sort of tragedy, he says. These children, he continued, are the tsunami generation. They are in a state of denial. The overwhelming view in Sri Lanka is that these orphans, who are already uprooted from their communities, must never be uprooted again by foreign adoption schemes. The humanistic position to adapt, sorrow and capacity for hope within the local traditions is laudable. The whole world feels this pain. Funds, volunteer professionals, and development assistance still continue to pour in. Britain's Chancellor of the Exchequer, Gordon Brown, remarked, I quote, just as we see the power of nature to destroy, we have seen the power of human compassion to build. Infrastructure can be rebuilt, stronger and away from vulnerable sites. Human lives are so scarred, to bring them back to flowering is a formidable challenge. But our society, in here the CUNY, is quite capable of strengthening these lives. We can bring their lives pieces together. Sri Lanka appeals for that help. We in CUNY can make this Sri Lanka's best opportunity to cut through this melancholy feeling. Experts who are conversant with the situation on the ground and have experience working in similar situations on other grounds have stressed the importance, I quote, of upholding local religious and social traditions of grief and mourning, as well as close family ties and community ties. Dr. Shekhar Sharma from India, a WHO mental health researcher working in Sri Lanka, said, too many irrelevant, inept, strange ideas from other countries could do a disservice to tsunami victims. there's a real danger that some attempts to help reflected more the need of the counselor than the counseled. There are major deficiencies in Sri Lanka's mental health system. With only 30 psychiatrists for the whole country of 19 million people, needless to say, it is spread extremely thin. Until last year, the country had no organized grief counseling, not in schools, not in universities, not in workplaces, not in family court, and not even in the defense forces. Even though in the past 25 years, Sri Lanka had one of the highest, if not the highest, per capita suicide rate in the world. Government policies in this regard have started to change for the better in the last year or so. Accelerating it is tsunami's inadvertent gift to the country. Health department has recruited 200 graduate counselors. They're now undergoing basic training. In addition, in conjunction with the Department of Education, 500 school teachers are being trained in basic counseling. This is only a stopgap measure, a weak one at that. For all volunteers of goodwill here in America, work will be most satisfying when they are in a familiar environment. Let me read what Nobel laureate physicist Donald A. Glaser said about 50 years ago. Physicists are like people working in a dark cave with a flashlight. It would help if they had a better flashlight. In other words, what he said was, a better and wider view of the environment one works in promises a better opportunity for success. Let me now take a detour to try to explain why the mental health system in Sri Lanka never matured. I'm going to need help from both Dr. Tam and Dr. Nehru. In Europe, from the Middle Ages through Renaissance on to the 19th century, there were no hospitals for the treatment of the insane. Insanity was considered a demonical possession. The insane were treated very badly. On the other hand, Greece and Egypt, before the common era, before the Christian era, treated the insane very humanely. They even had art and music to make their lives more comfortable. In Sri Lanka, at that time when I was growing up, a Catholic will seek priestly help to exorcise the demons. It's the age-old practice in from medieval times. Buddhists and Hindus will seek remedies in meditation, yoga, and Ayurveda. And sometimes they will find a shaman. The Buddha said that the mind is very susceptible to change. Mind is very malleable. Meditation is mind enrichment and mind exercise. With that, the mind can be adapted to a different set of conditions. The bigger picture here is the Buddhist thought on self-reliance and self-transformation. Dr. Edward Podwall, an MD, writes in his book, Recovering Sanity, that Buddhism gave a compassionate approach to understanding and treating psychosis. It is unconscionable that Sri Lankan society, in general, has moved away from that humane consideration to stigmatize the mentally impaired. It is important to note, for all of us, the religious distribution in Sri Lanka. 6% Catholic or Christian, 6% Muslim, 15% Hindu, and 71% Buddhist. But then we have a Jewish community, Jains, Baha'is, 75 Farsis, you name it, everyone is there. Next to India, Sri Lanka is the next biggest conglomeration or the melting pot. Everyone was taken in with open arms. They have everything, they can live all in peace. Now let me go back to refugee camps. A very disconcerting situation is the coercion exerted by human traffickers on orphans under the guise of legal adoption. All Asian governments are on the alert. UNICEF's director, Carol Bellamy, reflecting on her experience from prior disasters, said, "Bad people take advantage of difficult situations." Now, a few words about Sri Lanka's plan for its socio-economic development, which is the second chapter in my essay. It is a colossal undertaking. Disasters disproportionately affect the poor. Developing nations, Sri Lanka and Indonesia included, are the least prepared to face catastrophe. The rich nations have abundant resources and they have invested in preemptive systems against disaster vulnerability. Homes in California and Japan are built to sway with the vibrations of an earthquake. Homes in Bam in Iran, Bhuj in India, and Bandar Aceh in Indonesia are threadbare constructions. Let us look at the destruction from yesterday's 6.4 earthquake in Iran. We don't have to talk too much. We see the destruction in the papers. Just 6.4. Both California and Japan could have withstood that seismic force of 6.4 with no damage. Maybe some glasses would have cracked. In Africa, malaria kills 3,000 children a day. Poor people's existence is hand to mouth. There's nothing left for disaster preparedness. They can only flee and then build a refugee camp. The developed world's early warning system, a network of seismometers and tide sensors in Atlantic, Pacific, and Caribbean waters, can be extended at the cost of a fraction of their GDPs to the Indian Ocean. It is to be done soon, luckily. According to President Bush and Prime Minister John Howard of Australia and Junichiro Koizumi of Japan, it'll be a folly if the affected nations do not heed scientists' advice and pull away from the sustainable development plans. Aid organizations must prevent infrastructure development as tsunami fodder. There may have to be exceptions, very important exceptions. They will not change their lives, whatever the tsunami was. And they are the Mokan tribes people in Thailand, the Andamanese and the Sentinelese of the Andaman Islands, and the animals, especially the elephants. They have outsmarted the machines. They knew it was coming. For us, the town dwellers, we have mutated and lost our senses to measure those things. Through my hands-on experience in Sri Lanka in implementing socio-economic development programs in coordination with government, donor nations, and United Nations and World Bank, who gave expert support, I have seen a lot of waste and a lot of white elephants being built. Both the aid giver and aid receiver were responsible for these debacles. What comes to my mind is an adage coined by a Victorian politician, which says, it is not enough to do good. One must do it the right way. True today, true then, and true tomorrow. Rarely do third world host nations see foreign experts not imposing their views. Indigenous peoples are affected by actions taken by London, Washington, Paris, Brussels, and the like. Satyajit Roy, in his superb film, The Distant Thunder, is Oshni Shankat in Bengali, portrayed how incongruent actions of a few in England, the colonial rulers and their mercantilists, created the 1943 famine in Bengal. 6 million perished from hunger and hunger-induced disease when millions of tons of food were going waste in the ports. Sri Lanka has plans to connect its socio-economic development to the United Nations Millennium Development Declaration. Its goals are as follows. Number one, eradicate extreme poverty and hunger. Number two, achieve universal primary education. And number three, significantly reduce child mortality. Sri Lanka's literacy rate is in the 90% and more area. And its child mortality rate, I believe, is 4 per 1,000 births. These two items can and must be both qualitatively and quantitatively improved. There is a little bit of relieving news for all tsunami affected nations. The developed nations have written off all their bilateral debt, and soon the multilateral organizations like the IMF, the Asian Development Bank, and the African Development Bank will do the same. Now let me continue on socio-economic development. I would like to touch on Sri Lanka's social security safety net for the people living below the poverty line. This started as an exceptional program. About 20% of the population is now in that category. Both the IMF and the donors find it troubling. The safety net has two components. One, food stamps, and two, a monthly stipend. Sri Lanka's education and healthcare are totally free. The safety net originated in Buddhist India. Emperor Ashoka, 270 to 232 BCE, had it well organized. On the rock and pillar edicts, he etched his vision for people to read it then. And people can read it now too. They are still there to be read. The Peshawar one is, I think, very clear in Pakistan. In Kutadanta Sutra, the Buddha emphasized the role of the government in alleviating poverty. In Sigalovada Sutra, he spoke of self-reliance and employer-employee reciprocity. The limits of public assistance are in the middle of these two theses. Both Kautilya and Milinda discussed these issues in the court of Asoka's grandfather, Chandragupta. That was about 310 BCE. So, Sri Lanka's politicians' siren song is, hey, this is our heritage. Of course, it's India's heritage too. In my view, the IMF's rationale for changes in the programs must be taken seriously. Populism can go to the back burner. But the politicians only want the vote. I hope Sri Lanka's present generation will build strong and long-lasting infrastructure, conscientiously emulating the nation's forefathers who, starting in about the year 500 BC, raised magnificent structures a bit shorter than the pyramids, many still standing, ran paved and lighted streets. Don't ask where electricity was. There were oil lamps. Still in breathtaking shape, today you can see them. Diverted rivers into complex irrigation networks, still feeding tens of thousands of acres of rice in the dry zone, and painted and shaped art on rock walls and pillars, still capturing our awe and imagination. They paid attention to intricate detail. They thought about appropriateness and optimality. Now it is the present rulers to the fore. I hope they will follow. Nobel laureate Amartya Sen, writing about famine and disaster, said, "In a functioning democracy, where a free press is a roving sentinel, elected governments have a strong incentive to take preventive measures." I am comprehensively engaged in the relief effort. Sri Lanka, I know, is sincerely grateful to America for her care and generosity. I have a most heartfelt feeling of gratitude to the Staten Islanders and the College of Staten Island, and a very special thanks to the 9/11 Association for their immense support. The hospital our Staten Island Buddhist temple is now building in Sri Lanka will be named 9/11 Memorial Hospital. Let me now end my notes with a quote from Horace Mann. In 1859, this great American educator said, "Be ashamed to die before you have won some battle for humanity." Let us remember Bandar Aceh, to Darfur, to the Amazon. They are all humanitarian crises. Thank you. Let's have a little discussion and talk about it.
You seem to emphasize, you know, the fact that foreign assistance may be undesirable, or it could bring some sort of undesirable result.
Foreign assistance, especially in counseling, grief counseling, without knowing the countries, the societies, modes of grieving, how they mourn, and their connections, their family ties, community ties. If you go slap bang telling various other methods, we are going to fail, it might do harm. But we have to understand their thinking, slow-paced, the very poor people. Generally they get little carried away when foreigners come to help them because they think it's all good, no question. But it is all good, no question. It's all in goodwill. But we have to find that fine line. What is the best way to talk to this young child? What do we know? What should we know about her feelings? The connections, the social structures. That is, of course, the basis is the same in psychoanalysis. How you employ that is the difference. But to employ that, we have to know the environment. I'll give you one example, slightly different subject. In 1968 or 69, USAID gave us 50 trucks, Chevy trucks. They were white, USA, beautiful and wonderful. They were all left-hand drive. We drive right-hand there. That's number one. Number two, the roads were not big enough to carry these trucks in that area where the new project was. So that's one problem. Then we had a sugar processing plant. So we got aid from the UNDP. They brought in these machineries and huge American-made machineries. You know, the whole acreage we had cultivated in the country were not good enough even to wet the machine. Forget about making sugar. If we put all the sugar cane in the country, it won't even wet that machine. It was so big. So that's the inappropriateness of this. So we have to learn what is really needed. And we will learn. We have the wherewithal, we have the training, we have the experts. We will look into it, we will find people to tell us. I will be one of them, of course, taking along. Nehru will be one of us. And we will gradually go there. It's not a difficult thing, but we have to do it right. That is the important thing I emphasized.
You mentioned about mental health situation. Only 19 psychiatrists?
30 psychiatrists.
30 psychiatrists.
For 19 million
for
people.
For 19 million people. And so, now what about this 200 graduate counselors?
They were with bachelor's degrees, some in psychology, no psychiatrists there, psychology, a university degree, not medical school degree, and the others had psychology as a minor. The major may have been biology or something else, minor, because we were so short of people. The slightest connection to psychology they recruited, and they recruited 200. They are now being trained, I don't know by whom. I'm trying to find out by whom. Yes. Definitely, I have a feeling that's from the Indian Psychology Society, Psychiatrist Association. I have a feeling, because we are so closely connected to India. I mean, we are just the same. So I think it's India. But I'm not 100% sure at the moment, because this psychologist, I just gave the name, Saxena. He has been working very much in our place. And so it's so important that, but I'll find that. I'm very much interested in finding that out. I want to find that out. And then in addition, Shekha Saxena. Yeah. And they also have appointed 500 school teachers as school grief counselors. I don't know who is training them either, but to train 500, that's why my proposal came in, especially for that purpose. A crash, an immersion program for summer, like here, and training them. I don't know who is doing that, but I have a relation who is one of them. We spoke with them last week or so, but at that time her training hasn't begun. So in fact I mailed some books from here for her to read. It's a long way. It's a very long way in that area for us.
I think other people can ask questions as well, but I'm just trying to, draw some information from you, and that is, for example, foreign experts, they come in and they know their expertise in their area of study,
yes,
etc., and but you're weary about that, So, and as you do your immersion program, how do you propose to do it?
Yeah, they're weary about that. We are going to break that trend by letting them know, showing them that we know what you are.
How are you going to make the...
We have to give a training here before we leave here about the social issues, about the social structures. We will have to do that from here, and we go there. What the experts from here will do, Dr. Tam, is give the science of it, give the real Freudian thought or Nietzschean thought or whatever it is to them. This is how we are dealing with this. Now let us combine that, let us place that in this context. But we have to know that context.
Well, it's not, you know, I just would like to say, I'm not sure that, depending upon who your experts are here,
yes,
it may be a little unrealistic to expect that people here who are not Sri Lankan or not from, are going to be able to absorb enough information so that they can approach this situation from such a knowledgeable point of view. The knowledge that an expert has, and now I'm speaking directly from my own experience,
yes, post
9/11, which, believe it or not, had its own cultural problems. When I, just as a parenthetically, when I went into this, I worked with the members of a large corporation, American. All of these people, most of these people were American.
Yes, yes.
Different socioeconomic classes, different levels in the company.
Yes.
I would say 75% of them had never seen a shrink. You know, I was a shrink. I appeared there and I was a doctor somebody, and that was all I needed to be. It was the wrong thing. It was the wrong thing. They were afraid of me, and they had spent their lives. Not one of those people, of the 75%, had ever even seen a therapist. They couldn't imagine what we could give. They were, you know, they had all of the New Yorker cartoon prejudices against this field.
Yes, yes.
I mean, there were issues like that. And I had no way before I went into this situation of knowing who these people were, what their needs were, what their level of sophistication was. I only knew what I could do.
Yes.
I'm just offering this as a,
certainly,
you know, a different way of viewing it. I'm not sure that you even got the time. Let's say if you took me, if I were a person who wanted to offer my service, that I wanted to be available to the 500 teachers, not the kids, but the teachers who would be delivering the service. Between now and then, I think no matter how immersed I got, I mean, I would learn some things about Sri Lanka. I would never learn a whole lot about the 500 yeah. teachers I was going to be dealing with, never mind the children that yeah. they were going to be dealing with. However, there are things that I do know that are kind of universal, just as you said. And what got me through, and the people in the American Group Psychotherapy Association, and we worked with such a variety of people, all Americans, and we didn't even have that culture gap to,
yes.
we didn't get over, was that we knew something about how to help people with their feelings, how to help people who were in a trauma, how to help people, this little kid that you mentioned, how am I going to get him to deal with his feelings? Well, one of the ways you get him to deal with his feelings is to help him talk about his feelings. I mean, it sounds very simple, but it's really not. So, and I'm telling you that what I'm saying is that we have techniques that many of us have practiced for decades mm-hmm. without going in with a specific, this is what we're going to do first. And this, in fact, a lot of people who went into the situation with specific protocols for how to deal with grief, for example, didn't succeed. And probably for some of the reasons that you're talking about, that even though there isn't a massive cultural difference, there are massive differences. There are massive differences between people within the same group.
But the whole point is, Priscilla, we, the trainers, I'm not a trainer, but I'm just putting myself in here.
Right.
We'll be dealing with not the patient.
Exactly.
But
we'll be dealing with the servers.
With the server. But to the server, what we are going to give is the universal science. Is how, in a situation like this, you would ask questions. And you put that in the context of your own society.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's what we are planning to do if all goes well. We are dealing with the middle person. not with the patient.
Yes.
Rarely we will get the opportunity to talk to the patients.
But that also begs the question that you asked, because I think you raised a question about how, I was kidding around before about writing a paper called Assistance Resistance, how people who are not of the same culture, people who are viewed as strangers, and honestly, I was being viewed as a stranger in an American corporation where I looked and talked like everybody else. Didn't matter. I was a stranger, and strangers have, you know, there are certain characteristics that adhere to strangers that are not so great for entree. You had an entree problem. I imagine the entree problem would be...
I think that this is what we are trying to get at.
Right,
yes,
very
yes.
important.
Now, you had mentioned about, you know, this program for experts before they enter, you know, that they should learn about
yes.
all of this. Now, how are they going to learn about it? Any specific ideas, any specific programs that you
No, I don't
mind?
Know. I don't
For example,
know. Yes.
How does one learn more about the Sri Lankan culture? How about the Sri Lankan government?
Yes.
Consulate? That sort of thing.
Yes.
And also in terms of, say, for example, for people here to work with the groups over there. Now, what kind of arrangement that has to be set up? And in the setting up of all those arrangements, can, for example, that, you know, the whole social, cultural, political aspects, that, you know, can be somehow transmitted?
Yes. It is a difficult task within a short period of time to get a group of counselors going there to train a group of counselors. It's a difficult task, but something that we can do. Answering your first part of the question, Dr. Tam, I don't know how to explain everything to a CUNY counselor going there. But we will have some people, a group of people here in New York, especially a few Buddhist monks, who will give a good picture of what they should learn, what they should know about the environment, of the social connections over there, or the feelings of the traditions over there. But nothing will be perfect, I agree. But we have a few good people who can talk for a couple of hours, for a few days, and get, let me put it this way, a basic idea of the situation there. Going there and giving what we are going to give the trainers, is the universal science.
Can I just mention another thought I'm having, which is that I'm still being very practical, concerned about the entree problem. The point at which the trainers are educated or they're immersed, they learn as much as they can about the culture. I think any of us would want to do that if we could. I still have my doubts as to how much it's like learning a language. You don't learn it in your first 3 months at Berlitz. You just don't. So you get an idea of what you don't know, basically, is what happens to you. But one of the things that we discovered was that, or at least my experience was, that entree depended very, very much on close contact with people there who have the contact, who are part of the culture, who know the people, the leaders. So to give you an analogy, going into this corporation that I went into, the first day that I was there, which was 5-6 days after 9/11, I was told to go in and talk. They wanted me to go in and talk about stress reduction and stuff like that. And I, you know, I'm a psychologist. I know about stress reduction, what I read in the New York Times, frankly. I mean, I deal with it all the time, but it's not my topic. And I asked if I could meet with everybody. But I asked specifically, everybody meant 176 people the first meeting. But I asked I wanted the heads of the division, the people who ran the place is what I wanted, to be there. And they came because they were all so traumatized anyway that they just, anybody who said, please come, I've got something for you, they would show up. And I asked them if they would talk. If they would, in this specific instance, I asked them, would they please tell this assemblage what their experience was on 9/11? Where were they? What happened to them? what happened in their families, what happened with their workers, what happened, what was their personal experience. It was such a simple device. I didn't know anything about this company, just to draw the analogy, right? I knew nothing about it. I didn't know anything about the corporate culture in this place. They did. They did. So they could speak to their own people. And as a result, what happened was that then other people started to talk. And for, in this enormous group, it was just an amazing thing. And it happened every place that I went. So I'm absolutely certain that, you know, there's something in there to be gotten. But it was using the connection of the leader of the group, of their group, and going in that way. And then I sort of felt like I was riding in on their wings. Mm-hmm. I feel like it's so important because people get closed out. Many of my colleagues went to offer their services, they were given offices, and no one came to their offices.
I think that this is what we are trying to do.
Yeah.
And since, you know, we are really also recording this for, you know, to put on the web.
Sure.
So I would like to, you know, kind of like try to get more information
yes.
out of you.
Yes.
So that, you know, later on when people wanted to find out about things, they can get some information.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And so you are the native of Sri Lanka. You know the area.
Yes.
CUNY wants to go in there.
Yes.
So you said, okay, you have to come in there, you have to have this training session, boot camp before you come in. And so specifically, you know, how is that boot camp should be put together? What are some of the ingredients over there? Now, as I speak, imagine that Selma Botman, our executive vice chancellor, is watching this. So what do you want to tell him? What do you want to tell Timothy Stevens? What is it that you need?
First and foremost, let me start with the logistics. What we will have in place in Sri Lanka when a team from here goes. As of now, I have been in touch with three people who are working to get this project going for us. They are dealing with the Department of Education and the Department of Health in setting the groundwork to find where and when these sessions can take place and who will be the candidates. Now, I have basically given them the number one qualification, English fluency. Written, English fluency, and spoken, of course. Because they can't speak with you without knowing English. But of course, they don't need English to speak with the native. So that is the number one. And equally important, I said, bring more women, if possible, 100% women teachers for this project. In my view, I've read somewhere for some reason, they're the best suited to deal with orphans and children and widows, and even widowers. So that's what we have done so far. Coming back to what we will do to acclimatize, to give a fair understanding of the situation over there to the team we have selected here to go there. I haven't done too much work on it, but part of the answer I gave a moment ago is we will find experts, knowledgeable people, especially through the Buddhist temple. The couple of Buddhist monks are very good at doing, you know, conveying this. They're pretty good in English and they know the situation. And that's where we will start. I haven't gone beyond that to find psychiatrists and psychologists from my part of the world now practicing here. I haven't gone to that extent. But I will be able to find. Definitely I'll be able to find. There are definitely a few Indian psychiatrists that I know, at least one I know of. We can bring them in too to help in this project. the two of them together, will at least do a better than 50% training job before we leave for Sri Lanka to get this done. Now, we'll never be able to get 100% acclimatization. No way that we can do that in a short period of time.
Question.
Yes.
Now, not everybody's model is acceptable. Everybody has different approaches.
Yes.
Oh, now,
yes.
What about Sri Lanka itself in terms of the 30 different psychiatrists or whatever, or other kind of mental health practitioners?
Yes.
What kind of generally acceptable practices that would they accept, for yeah. example?
That part I have been thinking of. That part I have discussed with a pediatrician friend who is working for us in this situation. When the team goes there, first thing will be a training session for them with those psychiatrists, a little team of them, talking to our group and expanding on what they had already learned from here before going there. That will be the second step. That will be maybe the icing on the cake. That's what we have thought of.
Maybe, you know, as you said, that the qualification of the people that will accept the training
yes.
from experts here is that they must be English proficient.
Oh yes,
right?
Oh yes.
You probably need to think about what kind of qualifications the experts from here need in order to go there. And that you probably cannot get unless you are working with the people who are already in charge of those things.
Yes. So that is, you know, that's a gray area, because I mentioned we will find a few Sri Lankan psychiatrists practicing here. They are the ones who can give them part of that answer. Definitely, that part of the answer can also be given by my cousins from India. That can be done. Again, it's a gray area. It's a very gray area. The whole project is a gray area. We will never find perfection in this. Start with, we are doing something urgently needed. The stopgap measure to give a start and give some help to the orphans, to the widows, to get out of this rut temporarily. We will do that until the locals are ready to take over.
Quickly, I'm sorry, it's another question, and that is, you mentioned that there are two approaches, two chapters in your talk.
Yes.
One is the mental health, the other
yes.
one is
socio-economic
development.
Yes.
And you mentioned about children, you know, child mortality rate,
yes.
you know, universal education. Now, what are some of these things? You know, you mentioned so specifically about mental health, and we have covered.
Yes.
What about the other two?
The other part of my proposal to the Chancellor the other day is scholarships for the tsunami victims and their children to come over here to learn. And because, I think you mentioned it, Dr. Tam, that we must extend it to social work and psychology also. Wonderfully well taken, that is. That's an easier part. The qualified, we will find qualified number of students every year to come over here. CUNY will fund the tuition, free tuition, plus a small stipend. But then CUNY, as Selma Bortman said, cannot find lodging, board and lodging. I spoke to a friend of mine at the Polytechnic. Polytechnic has a building, half of which is empty. Those are their dorms. So my friend is trying to find out what can be done. Last night I was thinking of another point to ask you to speak to Russ Hutzler, now our president.
I'll do anything you ask.
Yes, to ask him to ask the Polytechnic whether they can give those domes at a cut rate, or join in the scholarship program and give the domes free. So he's the most suited person for this. He being my boss, I don't want to ask. You being his friend, you can ask. I was thinking of you last night on this subject, because after discussing it partially at the meeting in the morning, I thought, hey, I must ask Dr. Tan to speak to Russ Hutzler about the domes. My friend is going to give me more details, maybe tomorrow, maybe tonight. But I know that dome is half empty.
What about, you mentioned about this mental health situation. Now, what about the education part? In the university, do you have contacts with the university?
Oh, yes. I have plenty. I have quite a bit of contacts.
Working with some established institutions over there,
yes,
then it makes it much easier.
Yes. For social work, we have to go through the universities, and I'm in touch with some people on that matter. And yesterday I sent an email to the Dean of Physics, actually. He's a very close friend of mine. And he will be speaking to the Sociology Department Chair at that campus. And then there are other connections already established. Social work side is easier than the psycho side. Yes.
I have a question on that one. When you talk about these two sides, the socio side and then the psycho side, I guess this is my experience as a person who was born into Indonesia and brought up in Indonesia and brought up in India most of the first half of my life, people generally do not like to see shrinks in that culture. The moment you say, I'm a shrink, they'll say it. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, they don't want to be identified as a person who knows the shrink.
That's right.
That's a bad thing. All right? They don't even want to let others know that they have any kind of a psychological problem.
Yeah.
All right? But this is the kind of a culture I was brought up with.
So that's what I mentioned
if you say, yes. Okay, here's a shrink, you just go there and you can train a few people and they can do a good job. I don't think it's going to be that simple at all.
Well, until recently, it was not simple. But the country is changing, mainly because of the suicide problem. Country is changing. All these years, why it didn't mature, the mental health system in Sri Lanka never took off, because the stigma attached. They were outcasts,
yes.
The mad people. But the whole point was, before colonialism, it was not so. Before colonialism, the Portuguese, Bartolomé de las Casas, he himself died at 72, he was mad. He died. He was a wonderful human being. Wonderful, wonderful human being who was a soldier and became a figure, the Jesuit priest, I think, or the Dominican priest, I can't remember. A wonderful human being who fought for the rights of the native people. He found it so disturbing to see the Spaniards treating the insane. You know, they were killing them, they were torturing them. But that was the way medieval Europe functioned. It's insane, you're gone.
That's what happens in America. This is not a problem that's been solved here.
Social work they will accept.
Yes, yes.
They will accept humanitarian kind of a work.
Yes.
But if you start talking about any kind of a psychology type of work, they will just stay away. That's unfortunately the kind of an upbringing that people have.
Yes. What do we do if we don't treat these young people? What do we do? What is there for us to bring them back, the happiness that they are missing?
Well,